One of the main reasons I wanted to shift to more of this sustainable farming, strip-till, no-till, cover crops, was to be more profitable. And what I found was the more and more I looked at the, especially the strip-till, and that's really kind of what we were doing cover crops before, but not really looking at the profitability part. The strip-till was solely profitability. Reduce passes, make more money. You can call it sustainability, regenerative, but if it's not profitable, it's not sustainable. As a crop farmer, if I can't make money either through more bushels or through lower expenses, it's not gonna work. And what I found is, especially with the strip-till and the no-till, there's a lot of money that can be saved, but we're not seeing any changes in yield, like downward, but actually it's gotten better. So I'm saving on both ends. Less expense, more yield. And it's almost foolish how easy it is. There's some management struggles, but the economics really make sense. The cover crops, what we see now with the field view platform that we use to compare stuff, that has really shown, now that we're actually looking at the cover crops, as how is this making us more money. We've always had yield monitors, but now having the ability to create regions and compare where cover crops were and where they weren't, and to see that, it's quite astonishing how in just minimal expense, short time, we're seeing some very tangible yield differences and profitability increases. When we talk about utilizing cover crops and the economics, and are we seeing a benefit from it? Is it something that's going to become more and more mainstream just for the profitability standpoint? From what we've seen now and what we've done in the last few years, I can see that planting cover crops will gain traction just based on increased profitability. From what I've seen, it's a reduction in inputs is what's going to really help show the benefit, because where we've had cereal rye, our weed control has been a whole lot better. And if you don't have to use a pre-emerge herbicide before or with your soybeans, because that rye is growing early and outcompetes your weeds, there's $15 of savings there. And then if you do start seeing a yield benefit, at one bushel at $9, it almost offsets your seed cost. So I can see more and more people doing it. You talk about weed control in soybeans, with the different options we have now with the Xtend soybeans, the Enlist platform, the E3s, and your traditional Roundup Readies or your conventionals, and weed resistance, namely water, hemp, and ragweed, weed control is getting really, really challenging. The options are getting really limited, so finding some way to help with that weed control, I do believe cover crops are going to provide a role for that. I've heard people with interseeding in corn finding good weed control that way. I mentioned everybody's forming an opinion. The majority of our population are not farmers, and they're going to want to see things changed, and they're going to want to see more sustainable practices. They're already seeing that in the marketplace. Organic. How is it raised? Is it grass-fed? Is it organic? How are the commodity crops grown? Are they done with no-till, minimum till? Are they done with cover crops? I can really see a push for that too. If it's encouraged, or if there's a incentive to, hey, the market's gonna pay an extra, you know, 20 cents a bushel if you grow it this way, that's gonna encourage more and more people to utilize cover crops and strip-till and stuff. So I can see it really having a role in agriculture going forward. And in turn, people are gonna be more profitable because of it. The one neighbor that I custom farm for, plant and harvest his stuff, he's been conventional tillage. The last fall, he wanted me to strip-till an 80 of his. So I did that. The other one, he's managing more conventional. So we'll have a nice comparison there. It'll be different hybrids, but next to each other. He planted a cover crop before his late beans this year that we knew were coming late. That's a first for him. He knew they were coming late. Instead of working in a couple times to keep the weeds down, why don't you seed a cover for me? I've strip-tilled for a few different people that have heard that I'm doing it and wanted me to try some. There's more and more coming. People are asking questions and they're thinking, I'm just gonna keep doing it, whether I'm advertising it or not. But people are noticing and asking questions of, what are you seeing with that? What do you do? And we planted some corn into cereal rye, and the neighbor that had the beets and the oats, oh, you're gutsy. I don't know that you guys, I don't know that I'd ever do that. Well, I don't know if we're going to do it again, but it looks, right now, it looks really, really good. And really, we weren't concerned about the planters placing seeds because we knew that that would work. It was mainly the nitrogen management and putting some on with the planter, and then we streamed a bunch on with our sprayer with streamer nozzles and did a bunch that way, and then I side dressed some checks in there too just to see how does this work and what works. So it'll be interesting to pull up the regions after harvest and see, one, did the side dressing extra make any difference? So did we lose any from the broadcast application before we planted and it rained, and that's the beauty of nitrogen, it's mobile. And or did we really need that side dress? So we didn't leave a strip uncovered just because we're kind of sold on the idea that covering it works. I did have one check strip where I'd planted rye and then strip tilled it and left 48 rows without cover. It'll be interesting to see, and I've got that all marked in here too. So strip tilled with cover, strip tilled without cover, doesn't make a difference. And I'm hoping to see that the covers make a difference, because we got a great opportunity with our early maturity soybeans that we've got this nice window to get a cover crop. And cereal rye is easy. It grows anywhere and it comes back in the spring. And I really think April is historically our windiest month. And we have these winter weathered soil out there that are fine and powdery and broken down and no cover. And if I can have some cover come up as soon as it thaws out, basically, that's a benefit. And so I think having covers in the spring has just as much or more value to me than the cover in the fall. So that's why I like cereal rye. I've done winter wheat. It's not nearly as winter hardy, but it doesn't grow away from you like cereal rye. Last year I planted a 4-foot tall rye, and there's a lot of stuff. The one thing that I learned is somebody's always watching. Whether you're a parent, whether you're a kid, whether it's the neighbors, whether it's the people in town, and you think about us in rural America, there's people driving up and down that road every day forming opinions. And as they drive by this field in the winter and there's dirt in the road ditches in the snow, or in the spring when we don't have any cover and it's weathered soil and it's blowing everywhere, they're forming opinions. And they're forming opinions on the farmers, whether they know them or not. So if I can have a field that doesn't have dirt blowing, and if I can have a field that has a nice green cover crop growing in April, it's kind of a ray of sunshine. You look at these cereal rye fields, and they broke dormancy in March this year, it was a nice spring. And first week of April, there's a nice green. It really does something to warm your soul that you see this nice bright green, and somebody's watching and somebody's forming that opinion. So I think it's important to make sure that I'm putting my best foot forward all the time. And I enjoy that challenge.